Hello, my name is Frits de Mul, and this is part two of a presentation about light scattering by particles theoretical aspects. The contents of part one were an overview of scattering functions and plots of various examples, and the appendices are in part two, this part two, derivation of the dipole radiation formula and of the general scattering equation. Literature, most important, is the book of Van der Hulst, Light Scattering by Small Particles. But now we start with part 2, appendices, and we start with the derivation of the dipole radiation formula. Dipolar scattering. Here is a dipole, two charges, and with the dipole moment P, and that's given by the charge times the distance. We have an oscillating dipole with a cosine function, and we can write that the dipole moment is also a cosine function, and we only consider the time-dependent part. The time-independent part only gives rise to electrostatic field. We have to calculate the electric field in that point P, the point of observation, and that electric field is given by the gradient of the electric potential and the time derivative of the vector potential, the magnetic vector potential. But here is the dipole again, and the dipole induced by an electric field is a classical harmonic oscillator with the Z is the oscillating coordinate, and we assume that it is parallel to the electric field. The first term is the acceleration term. Here is the damping term proportional to the velocity. The resonance term, Fe, is the electric force that's equal to the charge times the electric field strength. M is the mass, and this is the harmonic part of the electric field. The solution is given by d or z as a function of time, with a prefactor here and a response function to a second order resonance system, in which the electric resonance frequency omega r is much larger than the induced frequency omega. And in that case, we can skip these parts of the denominator. And then we end up with the induced dipole P as a function of time, in which P naught is 2 q squared E naught over m omega r squared. And this, as you can see, is a constant factor multiplied with the electric field. The dipole moment and the oscillating dipole. Let's calculate the electric field now. The electric field is given by the gradient of the electric potential and the time derivative of the magnetic potential, and we start with V. We have the potential function of two charges. It is given by 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught times Q as function of time over the distance, R plus in this case, and here the counterpart with R minus. And Q is P naught over D naught, and D naught was defined in the previous screen. The distance R plus or minus is given by this formula here, and in fact, as you can see, this is the well-known cosine rule. And we use a retarded time. T prime is T minus R plus or R minus over C, and that retarded time accounts for the flight time and phase differences between the paths upon arrival at point P. Here is that expression again with the R, and now we use the far field approximation, in which D is much smaller than the distance of observation. And we perform a Taylor expansion to first order of R plus R minus, and that gives us R plus or minus is R. We isolate R first, And then 1 minus or plus d over 2r cosine theta. This is a second order term and we will skip that. And for 1 over r plus or minus, a similar relation can be found, but with the plus or minus reversed. Now we use the small dipole approximation. And that means that we say, assume that the distance between the charges is much smaller than the wavelength. In case of radiating atoms, this is certainly the case. And this means that omega times d over c is much smaller than 1. And in the following formula, we will use the relation cosine of a plus b. And cosine a plus b is cosine a cosine b minus or plus sine a sine b. We will do that in this equation here, cosine of omega t plus or minus r over c. And that can be written as the cosine of t plus or minus minus r over c, r plus or minus omega d over 2c cosine theta. And that follows from this expression here. This is a, this is b. And so you can see this is cosine a cosine b plus or minus or plus sine a sine b. And then, if a is small, then the cosine of a will be 1. If a is going to 0, then sine of a can be replaced by a itself. And then we end up with this equation here, is 1 times cosine omega t minus r over c, minus or plus omega d over 2c times this expression here. And here is the sum. And so we end up with an expression for the phi with a sine part and the cosine part. Here is an omega and here is an r. And now we use the small wavelength approximation, and it means that r is much larger than lambda, and thus this term will vanish, and we end up with this approximation, with this expression here, only the first term. Here we are again. Here is the expression with the two factors, omega and 1 over r, for a potential v. We can write when r is small, 1 over r is small, for large r, then we only end up with the first term. And here is the sine term. But when we have the electrostatic limit, for omega goes to 0, then we end up with a 1 over r squared term. Then we only have this term here when r goes to 0. And this is the electrostatic limit. Please take a break to figure it out for yourself. The electric field. Now we calculate the magnetic field, the vector potential. The vector potential is given by Biot and Savart's law as the integration over the current over the distance. And the current is the dq dt, and that can be written as q omega sine omega t. And q is given here, and that rho here, in this expression, rho is a function of z, the coordinate. Now we want the result at large distances. But this expression here, due to the fact that rho is a function of z, is tricky to calculate, and therefore we use an approximation, valid for large values of the distance. Let's replace the integrand by its value at the center. The center. And we multiply by the distance here, and the distance is d0. And we take d0 q is p0. And then we end up with an expression for the vector potential given by mu naught p naught omega over 4 pi r sine omega t minus r over c ez. And here we have ez and er and e theta. The two expressions for the electric potential and for the magnetic potential. Let's calculate the A field now. The gradient of phi and the time derivative of A. And for the gradient of phi we use the expression dv dr and dv d theta. And dv d phi will be zero. And for the A we have to use the expression in which the factor A is expressed in AR, ER and E theta. The factor EZ is expressed in ER and E theta. The final result when you calculate this is the prefactor here sine theta over R, in which sine theta is the scattering angle, and the cosine with the retarded time times E theta. And E theta is perpendicular to R. And you can see that the E field is proportional to the incident field, that's via pi naught, in which the incident field is present. It is proportional to omega squared and the intensity omega to the fourth power. It is inversely proportional to the distance, and for intensity is 1 over r squared. And the only component that's left is in the direction of theta. And we have the retarded time. Please note, when you calculate the derivations here, then you will see that the V field renders an R component only. But the A field gives you both R and theta, and when combining those, you will see that only the R the theta component will remain. Well, what is the emitted energy? Then we have to calculate the radiated power, and that's expressed in the Poynting vector, and the Poynting vector is 1 over mu naught E times B, factorial product E and B. The E is this expression here, with P naught is proportional to the incoming field, and analogously we'll find this expression for the B as the rotation or the curl of A, and that's this expression. And the A was given by this term here times the sine. Now perform the calculations. Here is the expression for the rotation, and EZ can also be expressed in ER and E theta, and when you perform the calculation you will find that the B is parallel to the to E phi, and E phi is the vector in tangential direction as is seen here, the E phi, and that leads to Ampere's law. And for the S, for the Poynting vector, we will find this expression with mu naught, p naught, and here the c, and omega to the fourth power. And this is the intensity, and you will see that the emitted energy is in the r direction, as you can expect. Now, for the final result, we found this expression, mu naught p naught omega squared sine theta over 4 pi r times the time factor cosine of omega t minus r over c, and this is the retarded time. It is in the theta direction. P naught is proportional to E naught. And now we can write k is omega over c, and epsilon mu naught is 1 over c squared, and then we will find this expression. E is P naught k squared over 4 pi epsilon naught times the sine over r function times the time function and the vector. And for the perpendicular component, we have to take the sine theta is 1. And here is the situation for the perpendicular and the parallel components. And now, in part 1 of this presentation, we found for the dipoles this expression here for the perpendicular and the parallel components, alpha, a factor alpha times ks over 4 pi epsilon naught r, and then either a 1 or a sine of theta, depending on when you look at the perpendicular or the parallel component, and there will be correspondence between the two expressions if you set P naught is alpha times E naught, as we have done before. Well, so far for dipole scattering, we now go to the general scattering equation. And then we start with the electromagnetic theory. The two divergences are zero because there is no charge and no current. The rotation or the curl of E is minus dB dt, that's Faraday's law. And here we have Maxwell's fix. The wave equation, when you combine these two expressions here, you find this expression, in which the rotation of E is minus mu naught times the double time derivative of d. And assume the scattering field is small compared with the incident field. And then we can write d is epsilon e, with the e is epsilon naught plus e1. And epsilon is epsilon naught, that is the zero factor. And epsilon 1 is the disturbance. And epsilon 1 is related to the epsilon r. And all the d's and e's and epsilons are functions of space and time. Let's assume that the epsilon 1 is much smaller than epsilon naught. And consequently, e1 will be much smaller than e naught. And this is first order approximation. And we will take the zero and first order terms only. And then, for the zero term, we find d naught is epsilon naught e naught, and d1 is epsilon naught e1 plus epsilon 1 e naught. Here we have the expressions again. And for the zeros order, we find the rotation of the field. The zero field is minus the Laplacian times e naught plus the gradient of the divergence of e naught, but the divergence is zero, as we have seen, and then we end up with this expression here. And the solution for this expression is the incident field, and that is a harmonic wave, and is given by a time function. Here, this is the harmonic function with a spatial harmonic part and a temporal harmonic part. And here we have the amplitude and the polarization vector. K is 2 pi over lambda, and omega is 2 pi times the frequency. And for the first order, we find this equation, Laplacian of d1 minus epsilon naught mu naught of this equation here, is a term with epsilon 1 e naught. And again, all these e's and epsilons are functions of space and time. This is the first order. We have a short derivation here. And please take a break to figure that out for yourself. The wave equation and first order is this expression here. Now we see that at the left side we have d1, that's the field we want to know, and at the right side we have the well-known field, the incident field, and the disturbance in the dielectric constant. And this is the well-known part. So we have to solve d1. And then we try this by defining a new vector function z using this definition here. And this means that we can interchange the time and space derivatives and write for z this so-called wave equation. But there is an extra term here with epsilon 1 e naught. We will find the solution using Green's functions, and the solution will be 1 over 4 pi times the volume integral over the scattering volume, epsilon 1 e naught, over the distance. And r is the distance of the origin of the scattering volume to the point of observance, as you can see here. T prime is the retarded prime, taken to account for the fly time and phase differences, and c is the light velocity. And the solution, this solution will be explained a little bit later. Here is the z, this is the solution, z is what here the volume integral over the scattering volume. Then with the e is given in this way, the incoming harmonic field, but at the detector the incoming field will not be present, and that means that d1 at the detector can be written as epsilon 0 times e1. For the d1 we have this expression because we used this. And now we use equality, in which the rotation of the rotation of an exponent with ikr prime integrated over the volume can be written as k times the same function, and f denotes any function of the arguments. The reason for this is that after the volume integration, k is the only coordinate dependent variable, and since k is a function of x, y and z, and r prime is a function of x prime, y prime, z prime, the integration and differentiation can be interchanged. And then we find that epsilon naught e1 is this expression with k times replacing the two rotations. And now we see we have the retarded time. As before, it accounts for fly time and phase differences. K times operator, that account for polarization directions, and we have an R factor in the denominator, and that is the spherical wave. And the square of this is proportional to 1 over R squared. Here we have the solution, and now the derivation. The derivation is leading to a solution obtained from this equation here. And the E is the harmonic wave. This is an equation of the form Laplacian of a function phi, this minus epsilon naught mu naught over the double time derivative of phi is minus a function of space and time. Now we use phi is psi as a function of the coordinates times of a time function, and what we do here in fact is separation of the variables. C is given by 1 over epsilon naught mu naught, c squared, and k is omega over c. Now we do the derivation in time, and then we end up with the Laplacian of psi plus k squared of psi is minus a prime, and a prime is a times the harmonic time function, and k prime originates from the differentiation in time, and that gives you the derivation, gives you an omega squared over c squared, and that is the k prime. The solution using Green's theorem: suppose we have a volume V that is enclosed by a surface S, then you can write the volume integral over two functions, psi 2 times the Laplacian of psi 1 minus the counterpart, is equal integrated over the volume that's equal to the surface integral over the enclosing surface times psi 2 and the derivative of psi 1 along the normal factor on the surface, and here the same for the counterpart. Here we have the Green's theorem again, and Green's theorem follows directly from the Gauss law. Here is the Gauss law: the divergence of a vector integrated over the volume is the surface integral over the component of that vector along the normal on to the surface. And when you substitute x for x psi gradient of phi to scalar functions, then the vector component along the normal will be psi over d phi dn, and the divergent is a gradient of psi, gradient of phi times psi Laplacian of phi, and this is in fact the chain rule for differentiations. So now we substitute for the x the psi 2 gradient of psi 1 minus psi 1 gradient of psi 2, and we set psi 1 is the psi we want to know in point P, and for psi 2 we try a spherical wave. A spherical wave is psi 2 the Laplacian of psi 2 plus k squared, psi 2 is 0. And now we can calculate the left side of this equation, of equation 1, the volume integral over psi 2, times the Laplacian of psi 1, the Laplacian of psi 1, that originates from this equation here, plus psi 1, that's psi here, times the Laplacian of psi 2, and that is the k squared, times psi 2. And that originates from this equation. And so you can see that the only term left is the term with a prime, and that's given here. The volume integral of minus a prime times the spatial harmonic exponent over r. This is the left side of the Green's theorem. Here we have the definition of psi, Green's theorem. This is what we inserted. And here we have the left side and the result for the left side. Now the right side. This, the right side is the surface integral. Well, we have to realize that P is the point of observation, and that's of course not in the scattering volume, so it has to be excluded from the volume integration. Here is that scattering volume and point P, and that exclusion, we do that by taking a spherical volume S prime around P and let S prime shrink to zero. And this means that we now have to split the surface integral into two surfaces, an inner surface, an outer surface, and here the inner surface S prime. And now, using for the outer surface, the derivative to the normal is d dr, when you assume the outer surface is a sphere, and for the inner surface d dn is minus d dr, because the normal points inwards. Then we can write for the part of S prime is here the psi 2 times d psi dr, d psi 1 dn is d psi dr, minus psi, that's the psi 1 here, times the derivative of psi 2 to r, and the derivative of psi 2 to r, psi 2 to r, then you have to do the derivative for the denominator first, that gives you an r squared and the factor here, and then do the derivative for the nominator, and that gives you a minus ik, and that's here. Here we have it again, the scattering volume, the P and the spherical volume S, and the expression for the surface integral over the inner surface. On that inner surface, the S can be written as R squared times the omega, because it is a spherical shape and the omega is integration element over the solid angle. And then, when we do that, we integrate over the solid angle, we have R squared d omega here, and then you can see that for the limit R goes to zero, for when you let the surface S prime shrink, that ends up with 4 pi over psi, and psi is in point P, the point of observation. Now we have now the left and right sides together. This was the result of the surface integration over S prime. Here is the surface integration over S. We have to perform this part. And here is the volume integration. Expression again. The surface integral over S prime leads to psi in P. The surface integral over S, the large surface, and here the volume integral. Now suppose S is very large, much larger than the scattering volume, and then A prime is limited in space, a finite scattering volume, and we contribute, and the contribution of S will then be zero, not only because of the R's, but also due to the time retardation, because it will take a lot of time for a very large surface to get your signals back in point P. And this means that the final result of psi in P is the volume integral of A prime times the phase vector over 4 pi R dV. And now we go back to epsilon naught E1 and Z. We have the relation for psi p, that's the volume integral, that's left only, and we have solved this equation, psi phi is psi times the harmonic time function, and this is relation, and z was represented by phi, and e naught by a prime is this function here, and so we can insert the z again, and E epsilon 1 E naught, and E naught is the incoming field, and T prime is the retarded time, and then we end up with the Z as a function of R and T, and that's the volume integral over the scattering volume times epsilon 1 E naught as a function of space and time, retarded time, and here we have the distance to the observation point. And Z was defined with D1 is epsilon naught E1 is the rotation of the rotation of Z. And when you insert it, we find for the final result E1 is 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught times the volume integral times the k times the epsilon 1 E0 vector products over the distance vector. And this is what we had to derive. This is what we have to demonstrate. The final result is given here. And me and other authors have calculated this integral expression for various geometries and dielectric constant distributions. And it can be said that when you have the incident beam has symmetry around the axis, its axis, then, and the scattering volume is symmetric again, of course, then you can do the an approach with Bessel and Legendre functions to calculate the electric field in special cases, but this goes beyond the goal of this presentation. This is the end of the presentation. Thank you for your attention.